In this video, I want to discuss the role of a back-end web developer. Now, this is part of a three-video series of videos that I've released on YouTube. Part one was one that I released previously. Click on up here to check that out. And that discussed the role of a front-end developer. But this video, we're going to talk about a back-end developer and the typical role. And also coming up after that, the third video in the series, I'm going to discuss the pros and cons of each. But for today, let's get started on the role of a back-end web developer. This video is brought to you by the Learn Programming Academy's Python Masterclass. Join close to 120,000 students and get 42 hours of video training, which will teach you Python the right way. Grab a massive discount and instant access by visiting lpa.dev/YouTube Python or by clicking on the link in the description of this video. Welcome back, my name is Tim Buchalka with another programming tip of the day. Right, so let's get stuck into it. We're talking now about the role of a back-end web developer. All right, so a back-end web developer, unlike a front-end developer, creates code that typically executes on a web server on the internet. Now, if you recall, a front-end web developer, they create code that typically runs in a user's browser on their computer, so basically it's executing on the user's computer. Contrasting that to a back-end developer who is typically creating code that executes on a web server somewhere on the internet, i.e. not the user's computer. Now, the back-end coder makes this layer of code available, or basically makes available key functionality to the front-end developer, or basically to any programmer who needs to access it to perform specific tasks. So things like accessing a database and so on. But it's probably best served by an example. So let's go and check out my Learn Programming Academy website again. Now on that website, I've got a list of all my programming courses. Now when you visit this page here, and then you click on courses, that then lists all the various courses that I've got available. Now the front end code, we're talking about how this code works, well that actually contacts the web server and effectively asks for a list of all the courses. So it's basically the code is calling the back end code and asking, give me a list of all the available courses in this case. So now there may be no courses, there may be one or whatever number there is. The back-end code in this case basically opens up the database. Now incidentally, the database also resides on that web server. So it's accessing that database locally, again on the web server, which is somewhere on the internet. And it retrieves the course information that it needs and sends it back over the internet from the web server to the user's browser again, where the front-end code, typically JavaScript or HTML, CSS, etc. Well, basically JavaScript is going to be the code that's executing to actually retrieve the information, and HTML and CSS is going to then style that and show that on the screen. So basically what's happening again is the back-end code sending the course information, I should say, back to the front-end code, which then basically formats it into a format you can see here on the screen and shows a list of all the various courses. Now, scrolling the list of courses, as I'm doing here, that's a process of the front end. So that's basically the front end code that's actually scrolling it. It's already retrieved the information from the back end code at this point in time, and it's now basically styling it and providing the nice layouts and fonts and so forth. But the ability to scroll that information, that's coming from the front end. Now, that's the case of if I'm retrieving all the courses, but then if I click a link like this one here, the Java Masterclass, I click on a single link, what happens is after that click is made by the user who's actually navigating the website, the front-end code will again call the back-end code. So it's setting up a list and said this time, instead of giving me a list of all the courses, send me just a list or the information for this one specific course. And so what happens again is that the back-end code then goes back into its database, retrieves the data from the database, in this case, the details of that one course, the Java Masterclass course, sends the information back over the internet, back to the front-end code, effectively being executed, remember, on the user's browser or through the user's browser, and then basically gives that information or shows that information on the screen. And you can see in that case there, we've now got all the details about a specific course. So you can see what the backend is doing here. Effectively, the backend code is exposing certain functions, like in these two examples I showed you, retrieving a list of all the courses or also retrieving the details of a specific course. But from the front-end code's perspective, it doesn't directly access the database. So basically what's happening is it's going off and calling the code that resides on the back end and saying, just give me a list of courses. So it's got no idea where that data is coming from. It's just called a particular function that the back end coder has made available to the front end to actually retrieve that information. All right, so Further to that, a lot of the key information, like retrieving data, which database is used and so on, that's usually hidden from the front-end code. So the front-end code, again, has got no idea basically how that information came to be, where it came from, whether it came from a database or, you know, which database. Did it come from MySQL database, Postgres, or did it come from a text file on the web server or somewhere else, you know, in the cloud perhaps? The implementation, the bottom line here, is up to the backend developer. What the backend developer does is expose some functionality to, in this case, retrieve a list of all the courses or return a list of all the courses or a specific course. Now, obviously, there's usually a lot more complexity to that, but that's it in a nutshell. And what that means is, as a result of this, is that the backend code could completely change the way that it stored and retrieved the data, and the front-end code would still execute and be none the wiser that anything's changed. So long as the same call mechanism, the same API call hadn't changed, you would still be calling, if you're the front-end developer, you'd call this function and retrieve a list of courses, not knowing that the backend coder may have completely rewritten that code or used another database or accessed it from another place. So I think that's pretty cool, this separation of concerns, if you will, and the ability to basically be a black box function, if you will, and not have to know how the backend code works. All right, so let's now talk about some typical programming languages that would be used in backend development. Now, some of the more common ones, PHP, was one, Java, C Sharp, and Python. Now that's just naming a few, but increasingly today, runtime environments like, for example, Node.js are blurring the lines of typical front-end and back-end code, and that's because they're allowing what were traditionally front-end programming languages like JavaScript, for example, to now run on a web server and not just the user's browser, which it typically used to do. So what that basically means is that you can now use Node.js, which is effectively JavaScript, for back-end development as well, and I think that's pretty cool. All right, so that's back-end development in a nutshell. And again, just a reminder, the next video coming up in this series will be part 3. We're going to go over the pros and cons of both front-end and back-end development, who gets paid more, and perhaps come up, hopefully, with a decision you can make as to which way you should go, whether you should be focusing on front-end or back-end, or basically even a combined role, which is another possibility as well, because some people, some programmers, web developers, go for what's called full-stack development, where they're actually able to focus on both ends. And we'll talk about full-stack development in a future video. Right, for now, though, that's back-end development. I'll see you in the next video. Alrighty, so I hope that helped. If you've got any questions, feel free to leave a comment and I'll get back to you. If you're ready to look at the next tip, click on up here and you can check that out. If you're interested in coding specific programming videos, click on the link in the bottom left-hand corner. Consider subscribing by clicking on the link up here, and I'll see you soon.